Santa Claus stood for a long time, looking at the puffer, while the professor and Sonny loaded all the presents on board. He went around the locomotive several times, felt the wheels and the boiler and nodded.
You have really done a good job. And you fire with Christmas cards, I see. Is it better than coal?
Much better. By the way, Santa doesn't happen to have any Christmas cards to spare. Ours are running out and that would be somewhat bad, if we would be standing in the middle of the line, on the very Christmas day.
For the first time in many, many years, Santa Claus laughed. Showed all his white teeth and laughed so it roared like a hurricane.
Sure, sure I have Christmas cards. Several millions. You have no idea how many people that write Christmas cards for me. And on most, it says something like this, how was it now? I have definitely forgotten it.
It wasn't by any chance like this. Almonds in every porridge. Soon every nut will have.
Yes, that's exactly how it was. People are weird. But it's nice of them to remember an old Santa Claus. Go ahead and take it for your use. The whole outhouse over there is crammed with Christmas cards.
Sonny and the professor filled the whole coal wagon with cards. Then they turned the locomotive on an old turntable, which Santa Claus used to use when he was bored and wanted to ride a carousel.
Is Santa ready then? Nothing forgotten?
Yes, my toothbrush. I have a special one with a hood on. One I only use when it's Christmas.
And then he came out with a long toothbrush with a red hood at one end.
The teeth should also celebrate Christmas in the right way. Yes, now we can go. Full speed ahead. I'm starting to get hungry. And you do serve porridge over there in Santaville?
Rest assured. Susanna has done nothing but tasting Santa porridge all morning. How fast do you want to go, Santa?
As fast as possible. Let's say, about 160 knots if it's possible. Otherwise we will have to settle for 150.
Pa, it's going to be hard for the professor. He's the one who shovels the cards into the furnace.
I'm helping.
And so he took one armful of Christmas cards after another. The steam pressure became so high that the needle on the meter bent.
How fast?
150.
It must be 160. We can shovel cards with our feet as well.
After a while, the speed was up to 160. The locomotive snorted like a racehorse. And Santa sang to his heart's content, rushing through the snow. They were now in the last curve before Santaville. Sonny put his hand on the brake lever. Now he already saw the station in the distance. And lots of people standing and cheering on the platform. It was probably high time to slow down. But nothing happened when he pressed the lever. He pressed and pressed and pressed. Threw himself on the lever, but not a single thing happened.
The brakes are broken. Now the cooked Christmas tree is fried.
The professor, who is a man of action, put his feet down and tried to brake directly against the wheels with the soles of his shoes. But it didn't take long until it smoked around the soles, and he had to pull in again. But Santa just laughed and laughed. This was the most fun he had ever had since his grandfather's reindeer ran amok in the late 18th century and took the Christmas presents with them, all the way to Australia. Susanna and Samuel saw how it was. The puffer whistled steeply all the time, and they understood that now it's time to do something and doing it quickly. The big syrup cake was in the middle of the coffee table. It couldn't be helped. It had to be offered. Susanna ran away with it so far away the station that she could. Right in front of the wheels on the rampant locomotive, she put it down. The puffer drove onto the cake and slowed its speed down. The syrup embedded the wheels and really tied them to the rails. but completely it didn't stop. With a heavy crash, it drove in through the large front door to the waiting room. But not much further. There it stopped. The coffee table managed with 6 feet to spare. Sonny and the professor looked out through the cab. Santa stepped down from his armchair. He looked very pleased. Nodded to everyone, who gathered around him. Nodded mostly to Samuel and Susanna, who stood in front of the coffee table and tried not to show how anxious and upset they just had been. From one of the carts, Santa took down a large sack. Slowly he went forward with it and set it in the middle of the floor.
Are there any kind station masters here?
Samuel stepped forward and bowed.
I'm station master here, and quite kind, I think.
And I'm a station master's wife and I'm kind too.
Out of the sack, Santa took 2 nice medals of real gold. Hanged one around Samuel's neck and one around Susanna's. The medals represented a Christmas tree in gold. It shone as if it were full of lit candles. Sonny and the professor came descending from the locomotive. Each they too received a golden Christmas tree around their necks.
Until next Christmas, maybe we should try and repair the brakes on the locomotive. It would be so expensive to build new station building every year.
So Santa Claus, will come to us next year too?
If I get porridge like that.
The porridge is served,
Susanna said and went out in the kitchen. The medal clanked for every step she took. When she came back with the steaming porridge bowl, she took extra small steps and it clanked like a small music box around her.
Before we eat, I have another medal to hand out.
Everyone looked at everyone else. Who could possibly get that medal? Santa went to the locomotive and patted it on the steam boiler.
To the locomotive the puffer,
he said and hung the 5th Christmas tree medal around the chimney.
And at the same time, to all steam locomotives around the world. The ones that are still out there. May they puff for a long, long time in our hearts.
Everyone cheered. Cheered and cheered and cheered. And the puffer answered. It actually echoed inside the steam boiler and that echo was going on almost all Christmas. The most festive Christmas in the history of Little Santa Will.